Thank you for dialing in. Welcome to the Singapore Business Series at the Singapore Pavilion Expo 2020 Dubai. My name is Su Yen and I will be the moderator for this event. I would like to introduce our panel of speakers. We have an excellent group of speakers this evening. Who will be talking about a range of issues on this very profound matter of climate change and the green economy. We will be starting off with Associate Professor Winston Chow from the Singapore Management University, who will be sharing with all of us what city-states like Singapore is doing in adapting and tackling climate change issues. After that, he would unfortunately not be able to stay with us throughout the whole evening. So if anyone has any questions, we would welcome any questions that you all may have, and Professor Chow would answer them accordingly. After his segment, we would be having Ms. Yolanda Chung from DBS Bank, who would be sharing with us what do financial stakeholders do to promote a more greener economy and help finance companies that want to be green warriors. Without any other thoughts about just the banking sector, we would then have Michele Ferrario, who is the CEO and co-founder of Stashaway, an asset management firm, which is another very important stakeholder who is looking at investments and investment returns in encouraging a greener economy. Of course, all that will come to naught if we also do not have the ability to monitor, to record, and to ensure that steps are being made in the correct trajectory in regards to a greener economy. And that will be presented by Dr. Rajiv Lal and Dr. Liang Hao from SMU. At the very end, we will have a panel discussion, and we would welcome all of you to turn on your mics or write out your questions in the chat room so that we're able to then have a fuller discussion with all our panelists. So without further ado, I'm going to invite the Associate Professor Winston Chow from SMU to begin his segment. Professor Chow, thank you.
Thanks, Su Yen. There's a video, I guess. Please watch this, thank you.
Singapore has a long history of incorporating nature and greenery into urban development. Green infrastructure, best seen in the vegetation surrounding the Singapore Management University, is part of the larger scale planning involved in making sure a successful city in nature exists. These trees play a role in providing shade and regulating temperatures from the urban warmth generated by cities. In Singapore, for example, the difference between temperatures in downtown areas like Orchard Road, with its forested surroundings, can be up to 7 degrees Celsius at night. More trees in its built-up areas can lead to a considerable reduction in this urban versus rural temperature difference, as green spaces transpire moisture, don't store excess heat in a day, and they do not emit waste heat, such as from air conditioning sources commonly found in Singapore. The green infrastructure also enables water to enter the soil and reduce the risk of flash floods, which, despite Singapore's best efforts to adapt to more frequent and intense rainfall brought about by climate change, is still rather high. These spaces allow water to enter into the ground and can be channeled to drains and rivers rather than pooling at the surface and contributing to flash floods. Park spaces abound in Singapore, as well as conscious design and planning that integrates nature with the urban. The presence of such urban greenery allows for spaces in which our students, faculty, and visitors can engage and reconnect with nature and its biodiversity, such as the verdant vegetation, on an everyday basis. Furthermore, urban wildlife, like the otters in Singapore's waterways, urban roosters and other animals, allows us urbanites to come face to face with nature here in the heart of the city. While Singapore is a small island, it has a big environmental footprint, especially on a per capita basis. We import all of our energy, as well as most of our food and other resources. One aspect that needs addressing in being a sustainable city-state is the requirement to stop using fossil fuels as quickly as possible, especially since emissions from burning these fuels is the key factor behind global warming and climate change. More than 50% of our greenhouse gas emissions are from energy generation and its usage throughout Singapore. Although it is difficult in Singapore to source for renewable energy due to our small size, cloudy weather, and lack of wind, solar energy is our best bet. Every little bit helps. And here in SMU, we have the largest solar farm in downtown Singapore, generating up to 1.35 megawatt power of electricity, reducing our annual campus energy consumption by 7.5%. Singapore's building sector has a large environmental footprint and will continue to do so in years to come. Buildings play a role in reducing carbon emissions, and the new SMU Connection building heralds the start of a new way of sustainable building and construction of infrastructure. It is built by using mass engineered timber as an alternative to concrete, reducing emissions as the wood stores carbon as it matures naturally, before being harvested for prefabricated construction material. Unlike concrete, using mass engineered timber as construction material also stores this carbon during the duration of the building's lifespan. Furthermore, the SMU Connection is also a net zero energy building, utilizing some of the PV energy generated on campus, and is Singapore's first net zero energy building in the city center. Applying new building technologies, which helps enhance the sustainability of the campus, is a key step forward in Singapore's actions in dealing with the climate emergency.
Urban greenery is a key component of modern urban cooling strategies. But this is by no means a new concept. Parks, gardens, roadside trees have long been used as means of providing shade and improving thermal comfort. This was aligned with 19th century concepts of health and well-being, ones that connected intimately to the Garden City model, proposed by then social reformers and public health specialists, such as Edwin Chadwick and Ebenezer Howard. These principles were well known in Singapore's history and were iterated many times by national leaders too, including the late Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew. Singapore Management University is embedded in this green past, situated on the original botanic gardens that were developed in the 1820s. This garden, designed as much as an economic research facility as a park, provided the urban center with much needed green space for a few decades. And today, the area has been revitalized to reveal the urban core's connection to its environmental history. Embedding our university, or indeed any business, within its historic environmental past allows us to reconceptualize urban working. It connects heritage with green solutions and connects us with our past, present, and future of urban living. This leads to greater public awareness of environmental challenges and solutions, as well as a deep understanding of integrating nature within the city. As we talk about climate change and the uneven impact of temperature rise on modern cities through the urban heat island effect, it's also interesting to note that the SMU campus has a connection to the types of climate records from which modern-day scientists build long-term temperature models. Our university has a hidden past. It was built over one of the original meteorological registering stations on the island, originally located in a 19th century convict jail, built to house prisoners transported from other parts of Asia back in the days when Singapore was a British colony. Weather records were made at this jail from 1869 until well into the 1880s. And this is an important record, not only because it provides very early climate data for the island, but because of the city center location. Such records are critical for building climate models to understand the pace of climate change, and especially urban climate change, from a time when the city was far less developed. History is a key route by which we can engage and educate employees, stakeholders, and the general public in green initiatives by grounding place in past, present, and future. History offers us a way of bringing the past to life and offering context to our modern challenges and solutions.
Right. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everybody. My name is Associate Professor Winston Chow from Singapore Management University School of Social Sciences and Office of Core Curriculum. And thank you for watching the video that my colleague, Associate Professor Fiona Williamson, and I helped to discuss and describe and to depict the extent of environmental change that has taken place in Singapore. You do note that it has been rather substantial, and it will continue to be substantial, no thanks to climate change and the Anthropocene. One example is that since 1950, temperatures in Singapore have been warming at twice the rate of global average temperatures, from a combination of the extensive urban development as well as from regional climate change. Like elsewhere in the region, Singapore has been subject to much more frequent and intense episodes of severe weather. I've mentioned that, for instance, we've seen more frequent and intense rainfall in Singapore, especially seen over the past 30 years, some of which have led, unfortunately, to more flash flood events in recent times, which is typical for this part of the world and has been experienced a lot as well in the region, like in Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia, and the Philippines. Now, these episodes of extreme weather driven by climate change will likely be more common in the future. The recent Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report that was released in August quantifies and shows how these climate-driven impacts that we currently face translates to risks. And these risks isn't good news for many parts of the world. Hence, there is the need for climate adaptation and mitigation approaches that are required to address these risks. And we mentioned quite a few in the video that you saw. The ideas and the principles behind these climate adaptation and mitigation approaches do work very well in Singapore, as Professor Williamson described. It is firmly embedded in the Singaporean culture, in the Singaporean context, and examples are best seen. Examples that have been deployed in SMU are seen and are effective, as we mentioned in that video. As an aside, how to support, how to upscale, and how to export these ideas that deal with adapting to climate risks, and more importantly, mitigating the causes of these climate risks, can be deployed outside Singapore. And it's something that I argue is essential in the immediate future. It's something that can't wait for 2030 or 2040 or beyond. It has to be done now, given the risks at stake. As much as the world faces a new normal post-COVID-19, and we all agree are looking forward to that, unfortunately and regrettably, we are likely to adjust to a new climate normal. And the bottom line is that the world will not be the same in the face of the combined risks of COVID and climate change. Now, that all said, with risk comes opportunity. And while small, Singapore has a very long and storied history of punching above our weight in several ways beyond our 750 square kilometers. And one fight, you know, if I were to use this analogy, that we have a large say in is how we can drive the green finance aspect that supports these climate adaptation and mitigation efforts in the region and beyond. And the discussion that the panelists, you know, subsequent in the next part of this session is something that I will look forward to, because we've seen the context of climate and environmental change in Singapore, in the region and the world. We have some idea of the risks that we face, and how to tackle them is utterly important, and how we finance the efforts to, as I said, to upscale and to support these adaptation and mitigation ideas is a very important discussion that should be held right now. But now that's it. Before we move on to that discussion, I would be quite happy to take questions either on the video or on the summary comments that I've just made right now. So I'll be happy to pass the microphone back to Suyen, if you are able to handle the questions, if there are any, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Winston. At the moment, I guess perhaps to kickstart one question for you, Associate Professor Chow. It is indeed commendable that the energy mix that SMU has been doing in terms of solar panels and all, and it is indeed, you know, very palpable, the urgency of the situation. But I'm curious about your thoughts regarding the changing of behavior and how do you ensure sustainable practices in just everyday life? Because there's just so much you can say, don't turn on the aircon when the environment's getting hotter, and turning on the fan and, you know, opening up doors. So I would like to hear your views about that. Thank you, Dr. Chow.
Yep. Thanks, Suyen. Changing behaviors is important. It's not just a individual behaviors that are critical in determining a more sustainable outcome. It's also important for the private sector, and it's also important for the public sector to be aware of that as well. Now, that said, one thing that drives the change in behavior is knowledge, is something as simple as talking about climate change and talking about the stakes that we're currently facing right now and the risks that we face in the future. A lot of climate scientists like myself, we realize that we know all this information, we know the challenges that we face, but the general public, not just for our students, but also their parents, their friends, their loved ones, they don't really realize the consequences that will be coming in the years to come. And something as simple as starting a conversation to alter behaviors, the knowledge transfer from these conversations can help to drive this behavioral change that is essential towards building resilience to climate change, or ultimately looking out for a sustainable outcome. As we know, sustainability is bearing in mind the future generations, outlook of the world with an eye towards present development. And you can't have that when people are unaware of the consequences and the risks that we face of climate change.
Thank you very much, Associate Professor Chow. It's a wonderful segue, and thank you for your time. For me then to introduce the next speaker, Ms. Yolanda Chung, a very important stakeholder in ensuring that people who want, or companies that want to be good green warriors, can get the financing that they need. So Ms. Yolanda Chung is from DBS, and she's the head of sustainability for the bank. And I would like to now ask her to please share with us the efforts that DBS is doing in this front. Ms. Chung, thank you.
Certainly. It's a great privilege to be invited and attending the Singapore Pavilion at the Dubai Expo, although virtually. Allow me to show my screen. I will be using a few slides to help structure the discussion. So today I want to talk about sustainable finance. What does it mean? You may have read a lot of news articles, heard from friends, or maybe you are in the industry on sustainable finance. I want to start from the very beginning when we talk about sustainable finance, because it is not just about green loans or green bonds that you have read about in the newspapers. The origins or the key drivers for sustainable finance actually come from environmental and social risk management. These days, you may have heard the abbreviation ESG a lot, environmental, social, governance factors. And back in the day, and I would say this is when I first started in this industry more than 20 years ago, betraying my age here, ESG was not really widely used. And the driver for sustainable finance in the very beginning is actually to do with how to manage the environmental and social impacts of the economic activities that banks finance and facilitate. We face a lot of motivations and pressure from different stakeholders, from NGOs. In 2015, there was a seminal report coming from WWF about sustainable finance in Singapore, Indonesia, and Malaysia. That report card on Singaporean banks did not look good. In response to that growing pressure, the Association of Banks in Singapore came out with a 4-page guidelines on responsible financing. So I emphasize on the 4-page. Actually, the real content only rested on the 2 pages. But that was the beginning of, of a principles-based direction on what constitutes responsible financing. Now, coming to the present day, MAS, the Monetary Authority of Singapore, came out with a set of guidelines on environmental risk management for banks, for asset managers, and for insurance companies. Each part of the financial community has their own guidelines. And the guidelines, I can tell you, are far more detailed, far more prescriptive, and there is high expectation coming from the regulator what banks, asset managers, and insurance companies should do to manage environmental risk. Then on to SGX, the Singapore Stock Exchange has also come out with a consultation and providing guidance on what constitutes quality sustainability reporting. These are all key drivers to promote sustainable finance. If I were to give you a few numbers why we believe sustainability is something that we do not out of goodwill, not out of anything that we want to just look good, it's because we are doing this for sound financial and economic reasons. Research after research, many of them that will be coming out of the likes of the SMU and reputable institutions, have pointed out that companies that actively manage and plan for climate change risk and impacts enjoy a higher return on investment. We also know that many of them who focus on ESG issues tend to have better financial performance. I know at DBS, we have done a lot of retrospective analysis to look at companies' ESG rating. So it is a rating on the performance of the company in managing environmental social governance risks and leveraging the opportunities, the ESG rating, and the credit rating of those same customers. We found a small correlation so that we can see the direction of travel of a company that is well managed for ESG matters also tend to be more creditworthy customers. We know that consumers now they're not only paying lip service to buying green, they are willing more and more so to pay a premium for buying something that they demonstrate a credible provenance coming from a sustainable source. And the business adoption of sustainable practices has also really changed the industry landscape. We know that there is now a lot of pressure for suppliers in Asia to cater to the environmental health and safety standards set by their buyers. At DBS, we look at sustainable finance as becoming mainstream. That's where we are driving at. We believe we can integrate sustainability components into all banking products and services. In my own role, I cover sustainable finance for Institutional Banking Group, the corporate banking business of DBS. And there, we are integrating sustainability into our products in lending, in trade and transaction services, in all the fixed income or bond issuance business and derivatives. There are two main structuring formats when it comes to sustainable finance. The first, on the left-hand side, we call it use of proceeds specific. You may have heard about a green loan for a green building. That is the most straightforward illustration of how a sustainability use the proceeds specific format is done. The entirety of the money borrowed or money raised in the market has to go towards the earmark eligible green projects. And the definition of what is green, what is sustainable, is at the discretion of the company concerned. Then onto the right-hand side, the second format of structuring sustainable finance transactions is to be sustainability linked. The reason it is called linked is because it is linked to an improved outcome. We will be sitting down with the customers, understanding what their material impacts are, what will be the metrics that would demonstrate improvement in their performance, and set out targets, whether it is for a loan or it could be for a bond, or it could be for a derivative transaction. When the customer meet the target, they are able to enjoy a discount in the interest margin. Effectively, the bank is offering an incentive, almost a subsidy, to incentivize our customers to do better. These days, the most important KPI and target that we set for customers is to do with climate change mitigation and sometimes also adaptation. Some of the examples of what constitutes green are shown here, whether it is in power generation through renewable energy, improvement in energy efficiency, pollution prevention and control, all the way to green buildings. But it's not just about the green or the environmental, the E in ESG, that we are concerned with. Social projects are also important, and in the market now, there are now social loans, social bonds. And examples of eligible social projects include providing assets to affordable housing, microfinance, providing access to quality education that is also affordable, especially for some of the population, segments of the population who may not otherwise be able to enjoy education, and women's livelihood. Then let me introduce another label here, transition. Last year, DBS was the first commercial bank in the world to come out with a transition finance framework and taxonomy. What we aim to do is to pinpoint economic activities that would represent incremental but important improvements in the decarbonization pathway. We know that some of the companies in Asia, they are still reliant on fossil fuels. They may still be using coal. And what we want to do is to have a label that is honest about where they are in decarbonization. They don't claim to be green because they are not, but they do embark on a pathway whereby they are transitioning to a destination that is aiming to be net zero by a certain time in the future, preferably by 2050, as the science dictates. And with that, that's the end of my presentation. I hope that this has sparked some ideas and questions, and I will be happy to answer them.
Thank you, Ms. Chung. It has indeed sparked a lot of questions, and we look forward to those questions at the end of the session. And you know, a lot of new ideas that you've brought up. So thank you very much for sharing with us what DBS is doing. Now, the other stakeholder in terms of the financing part is Michele Ferraro, who is the co-founder and CEO of Stashaway. And I would like to now invite him to share with us what his firm is doing to promote green, a more green economy. Michele, thank you.
Thank you, Suyan, and thanks everyone for having me and listening to me. So I will share a short deck I prepared to guide the conversation, and then I will be very happy to answer any questions later on. Of course, the angle that I took in preparing some material is not about what Stashaway is currently doing, but rather answering the question, what is ESG investing? And then maybe hinting at a few things that we are thinking about and we have been doing. So before I start, just a second on who I am, just to give context. As Suyan mentioned, I'm the co-founder and CEO of Stashaway, which is a digital wealth management platform. So what we do is helping people invest their savings. We are regulated and live in 5 countries. We are started in Singapore, but we now also have a presence in the Middle East through our DFFC license. I'll talk a little bit later about what we are doing and what we're planning to do on ESG. Broadly speaking, we are not an ESG-focused player. We help people invest their money and build their wealth over a long period of time. Now, the first question that I was asked to answer is, what is ESG? And many people think that ESG means, you know, investing in clean energy, but that's actually not just the case. ESG as Yolanda mentioned earlier, is actually a bit of a broader spectrum of factors that that influence investing activity. So ESG stands for environmental, social, and governance. And so each of these letters actually stands for things that are quite broad and different. When you think about environmental and you're thinking about investing, you might think about climate change, you might think about water pollution, you might think about energy efficiency or water scarcity or biodiversity. There is a range of different things. When you then look at social, these are maybe less known, it's a less known factor and is an equally important one. It's about looking at gender and diversity policies, about human rights, employee engagement, community relations, and so on and so forth. So investment in ESG not only include investments into companies that are looking at doing good for the climate, for instance, or for the environment, but also look at problems which relate to human rights, for instance. And lastly, ESG investments also look at governance of companies. So how are the board composed? How is the executive compensation built? Is there an audit committee? How is the structure? Are there kind of basic policies like bribery and anti-corruption policies, et cetera, et cetera. So ESG is a very broad definition to look at investing that looks not purely at financial returns, but also at kind of sustainability in a broad sense, not just environmental. So you can look at how does ESG stack into the continuum between looking just at financial gains or also looking at sustainability and social impact. And ESG investing is not about, it's not philanthropy. It's not just investing to or sending money to do something good for the planet. It's a bit more nuanced. It's about investing, focusing on financial gains, while at the same time having an eye on sustainability across the three metrics I mentioned earlier. So it's different from impact investing, for instance, which is when people invest with primarily a sustainability or a social impact, and secondly, they're also looking at making a return on investment. So understanding the difference is very important because ESG tends to be used quite broadly, and in reality is actually a specific style of investing. Now, why is ESG complex? Why is it not straightforward? The reality is that while it's easy to identify, you know, the factors I mentioned earlier regarding environmental, regarding social impact or governance, and you know, we can go easily into the details of what clean waters can mean or pollution means or you know, board composition can mean. In reality, then it's very difficult to track all of these factors. And across the globe, there's no unified regulation that helps investors make sense of all of these factors. It's also difficult to quantify the financial terms, and there is no universal standards. There is a couple of companies that have tried to do kind of a favor to the investment world, providing scoring, ESG scoring. So MSCI and Morningstar, for instance, and there is a few more, but these are the two biggest ones that actually came out with ESG scoring so that fund managers and investors can actually look at a number to understand how a company is scoring against environmental, social, and governance issues. As mentioned earlier, ESG investing is not just about doing good. There is an investment component to it, and it's about driving positive return. So a myth is that factoring ESG criteria into an investment model would come at the cost of reducing returns. But that's actually not true. In fact, sustainable companies are proving to be more likely to generate scalable returns. And this has happened over a sustained period of time. Actually, I think Yolanda also shared some numbers earlier about how companies that actually have an eye towards sustainability are actually performing better. And obviously the same happens when you look at them from a stock market perspective. And maybe I'll highlight a couple of factors that are driving this phenomenon. One is more defensive. So when you invest in a high ESG scoring company or a basket of high ESG scoring companies, you actually are less likely to invest in companies that might engage in risky behavior or short-sighted behavior. Remember that ESG includes governance issues. It also means that probably the company is on the right side of regulation, so there may be less regulatory risk in many, many areas. And so it has a kind of bit of a defensive angle to it. The second thing is that because there is an increase in demand for ESG assets, and this has been actually quite significant, as you can imagine, the law of offer and demand works in investing as well. And so the more demand there is for a certain type of asset, for ESG assets, the more the price will go higher, given and if the offer is the same. So that's what's been happening over the last few years. And if you look at numbers, over the last 13 years, so this is number from 2007 to the end of last year, ESG factor has actually driven significantly positive return. Has been actually the, you know, when you look at factor investing, it's been the second best factor in terms of predictive returns. You know, second only to quality, which in a sense is actually quite correlated to it, and much better than, you know, dividends, for instance, much better than value or size of the company. And the interesting thing is that it has, the interesting thing is that it actually has been providing positive return even when even when the broad market is actually not generating positive returns. So as mentioned, one of the factors driving this is an increase in demand, and the reality that we are still at the very beginning of the journey. You know, there is increased awareness. The fact that we're speaking about it today is obviously a clear factor in that. You know, globally, these are numbers from Bloomberg. Bloomberg expect in the next few years the ESG assets to go up to over $50 trillion from around $30 trillion today. So that's obviously a very significant increase, nearly doubling in the next few years. And when I look at Singapore specifically, Singapore has in the last few years focused more and more on the topic. I think the previous speakers both have spoken about that at length. I'll give you one example. I remember at the FinTech Festival in Singapore a couple of years ago, Ravi Menon from the MES actually opening up, speaking about the importance of green finance and therefore in general thinking about an environmental angle to investing. Maybe more than ESG is more environmentally focused, what we've seen Singapore focusing today. To the point that, for instance, earlier this year, the MES has announced an allocation of 2.4 billion Singapore dollars, close to 2 billion US dollars, to climate-related investing. And as Yolanda mentioned earlier, there has been a lot of work from the regulator on engaging with the industry on how to regulate further investments that are, you know, socially conscious, either because focus on environment or maybe more broadly on ESG. So on our side, as I mentioned at the beginning, Stashaway, you know, we are a wealth manager managing over $1 billion, and we have been obviously looking at ESG. We as one of the things that we want to over time increase our focus on. We've done a few things. One is we've actually now scored all of our portfolios that we offer to the clients using both the MSCI and the Morningstar ratings. So the clients can actually go to the website and see what are the scores for each of our portfolios and have that further information in their hands as they decide whether to invest with our company or not. And then secondly, we've actually started to introduce within our array of funds that we use, ETFs that we use, two pure ESG vehicles, one focusing on equities in the US, the other one focusing on equities in emerging markets. And then we leave to our system, to our algorithm, to optimize these assets within all of our sustainable, all of our universe. What in practice means is that these ESG assets actually add diversification to a portfolio, because as I showed earlier, they tend to actually have different returns from other assets, especially when the markets get particularly volatile. So we expect actually over time to potentially increase our exposure to purely ESG assets and to focus even further on that. So to close this conversation, I wanted to maybe leave the audience with a couple of points on how to invest sustainably. So first of all, it's always good to start with understanding why you want to do something. So why you want to invest in kind of with an ESG focus. Second, one easy way to screen investment proposition is looking at ESG scores. As I mentioned, MSCI and Morningstar are the two larger producer of the scoring. And so this is actually a good, easy place to start. And lastly, never forget, even when you look at ESG investing, never forget the basic rules of investment. Make sure you're building a diversified portfolio. Make sure you're not putting all of your eggs in one basket. This is true even if you are trying to use sophisticated factors like ESG to screen your investments. So I will like to stop here and give back the word and the microphone and actually the screen as well to Suyen for the continuation of the conversation.
Thank you, Michele. A very interesting presentation, and we definitely look forward to having further discussions with you later. And you have kindly also set the scene for me to introduce Dr. Rajiv Lal and Dr. Liang Hao from the Singapore Management University, who would be speaking about reporting and reporting standards, because without that, it's going to be impossible to figure out if companies are meeting ESG criteria. So without further ado, Dr. Lal, Dr. Liang Hao, please, your session. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Suyen. Can whoever's controlling the screen bring up the presentation, please? Yeah. Thank you. I will kick off this segment with a little big picture introduction on some terminology that has been quite loosely used. So we've talked up till now about ESG. I wanted to introduce and expand on the notion of the green economy. What is a green economy? There are lots of definitions floating around, but I have picked one which is very simple and succinct, and it comes from the United Nations Environment Program. A green economy is essentially a low carbon economy that is resource efficient, and interestingly enough, is also one that is socially inclusive. A green economy focuses on nurturing and developing climate-aligned technologies, climate-aligned incentives for market development, infrastructure development, and skills. Why is the concept of a green economy becoming more and more relevant today? Well, as we heard at the very beginning of today's presentations, Professor Chow, who was a member actually of the IPCC, the evidence is very clear. We are facing a rising frequency of adverse climate events. And these climate events, we've seen it earlier this year, you know, from the forest fires in Australia and the United States to flooding in China, in the Philippines, in India, in Thailand, even in Germany. These events are causing increasing economic and financial dislocation. And what is important is that not only is this dislocation and economic damage detrimental to economic growth and makes risk management very important, but its implications are not evenly shared between rich and poor. Unfortunately, the impact of adverse climate effects is falling disproportionately on the poor, which is why, presumably, the United Nations has deemed it important to include the concept of inclusiveness in their definition of the green economy. Next slide, please. So I wanted to turn next to risks and challenges, and opportunities and challenges that a transition to a green economy throws at us. And I will first deal very quickly with the challenges and opportunities at the macro level. But in essence, greening our economies involves fundamental change. It involves fundamental change in the nature of our businesses and in the nature in which our economies function. Any change means potentially huge opportunities. You just take the example, which is so well known, of Tesla. Here is a company that has very successfully introduced a new technology for mass production of electric vehicles. And as a result of that innovation, they have generated a huge amount of value. So as we green our economies, there is a big opportunity for entrepreneurs, for businesses to reposition themselves and take advantage investing in innovation to create value. So it is not the case, it is not necessarily the case that we green ourselves at the expense of growth. There is an opportunity to actually deliver rapid growth, profitable growth, along with greening at the same time. As for the challenges at the macro level, the biggest challenge that we face is the risk of transition. Any change involves winners and potential losers. How we manage the potential losers is going to be of very great importance and significance. You take the example of the coal industry in the United States. Coal mines in the United States are now finding it hard to gain access to financing because of the changes in financial markets and their increased concern with sustainability. And this is causing stress in the coal sector in that country, which they must adapt. So what policies, what support, what incentives can be provided to help them through this transition is going to be one of the biggest macro challenges that we face in a transition towards a green economy. Next slide, please. Now at the micro level, when I say micro, I'm really talking about the company level. Lots of changes are already happening, well underway, that are going to affect companies. So there's going to be greater regulatory intervention that companies will have to get used to. They will have to transition their business models. Their boards, as Michele was referring to, will have to deal with more onerous fiduciary obligations as people look to their commitment to ESG. And there is an important need for businesses now to interact with a wider group of stakeholders because consumers, especially the next generation of young consumers, were becoming increasingly conscious of sustainability issues. They will hold companies to account for their behavior. For each company, there is a risk and there's an opportunity. Companies that deal with regulations well will have greater operational flexibility. Companies that discharge their fiduciary obligations well have the opportunity to create huge long-term business value, but there is equally risk. So I hope this gives you a flavor for the types of opportunity and the challenges that we will face as we transition to a green economy. Next slide, please. Next slide. Okay. This is to give you a sense for where Singapore stands with respect to a transition towards a green economy. The Singapore strategy is contained in what is called the Green Plan 2030, broadly speaking. And it has, as you might expect, three broad elements. It has public policy elements that sets goals and sets policies to help economy transition towards green. It involves a huge commitment to investment in public infrastructure, not only in public transportation that is more energy efficient, but also to protect the island's coastlines in the future. And it has a huge and growing regulatory and financing component, which is intended to change the behavior of businesses and finance companies in Singapore so that they become more climate aligned. It is a comprehensive agenda that Singapore has adopted, and it is gaining momentum as we speak. Finally, next slide, please, the last one for me. Can we get to the next slide? So this is just a little description of who we are, as in Professor Liang Hao and myself. We are affiliated with the Singapore Green Finance Center of the Singapore Management University. This is a recently launched initiative which has the backing of the Monetary Authority of Singapore. It's a collaborative initiative with Imperial College London, and we have the support of marquee finance in financial institutions in Singapore. And our mandate is essentially to conduct multidisciplinary research and help develop talent in the area of sustainability, climate, and green finance to support Singapore's transformation into a green economy. My final comment is that you cannot manage anything that you cannot measure. And as, again, Michaela referred to before, one of the challenges with implementing ESG is setting measurement and standards that everybody can understand. This is a subject that the SGFC has been researching on, and that is particularly the subject of what Professor Howe has been working on. So I will now pass the mic back to Suyen so that she can facilitate the transition to my colleague, Professor Howe.
Thank you, Professor Lal. Thank you, and it's a wonderful presentation that you gave, lots of ideas and also lots of questions that I hope that people will start asking. Without further ado, I would like to invite Professor Liang Hao to talk about how we monitor, how we record, and ensure that people are really going towards the right direction in terms of a green, sustainable practice. Thank you, Dr. Liang Hao.
Okay, thank you, Suyen, and thanks, Rajiv, for talking about Singapore Green Finance Center, which I'm also affiliated with. Let me share my slides on my end. So my name is Liang Hao. I'm an associate professor of finance at Singapore Management University. So my role is a researcher. So I would like to take this opportunity to shed some light on this topic from an academic perspective. So when we talk about green finance, you know, in an academic way, then what kind of issues we are talking about? I think there are three pillars of green finance. One is to look at corporations. For example, we look at how companies, they finance their green projects by issuing green bonds, by issuing other securities. And also if they do this kind of corporate social responsibility commitment, then what is the financial implication for doing so? So this is the first pillar, taking a corporation's perspective. And as some of the speakers already mentioned, there is robust evidence finding a positive correlation between, you know, companies being green and their valuation, their profitability. The second pillar is from an investor's perspective. So there are many research papers trying to look at what are the returns to green investing. And if an investor does engage in green investing, then what kind of strategy they use? Is it simply an active screening? Namely, investors do not invest in certain stocks seen in industries, or is it ESG integration? Namely, they try to integrate environmental social considerations into their financial modeling, into their analysis of valuation, or the impact investing, that they have the intentionality to create impact, and they also have a system to measure impact. And people also look at investors' different ESG preferences. We know that not everybody has a, you know, entirely monetary incentive. People do recognize that investors have non-monetary incentive, and there is robust evidence that many investors, individual investors or institutional investors, they are willing to trade off some financial returns with social and environmental benefits. The third pillar is more from a policymaker's perspective. So what kind of regulatory frameworks are conducive for ESG or green investing? And earlier, Suyen also mentioned about, you know, what are the standards for ESG reporting? And you know that in EU, there are many regulations, directives, and also taxonomy with regard to environmental products, environmental behavior, and how you can label sustainability in your investment products. These are all important issues. And the key concern here is that if we don't have a robust measure for ESG and we don't have a standard for ESG reporting, there may be a concern for greenwashing. And also what kind of public financing incentives are available to drive corporations and investors to engage in ESG investment, such as tax exemption, subsidies, etc. So if I were to put so by the way, the combination of these three is what I call green finance. So if I were to put these elements into green investing and compare it with traditional investing as well as philanthropy, I think Michele earlier mentioned about their difference, but here I show it in a graph. On the vertical axis, you have the traditional financial return. On the horizontal axis, you have the environmental and the social impact. So traditional financial capital basically maximize financial return only without any consideration of social and environmental impact. So they are on the very left, whereas traditional philanthropy, they do not demand for financial return, but care a lot about what kind of impact they create to the society. So they are all the way to the right, whereas ESG investing, or what we call socially responsible or sustainable investing, they are in the middle. So they are basically blending social and financial returns. And also, as mentioned by other speakers earlier, there are more than $30 trillion globally invested in ESG in green finance. The key question is, how do we measure it? How do we report it? So about 2 years ago, we started a project together with a leading bank in Singapore, DBS, and Impact Institute in the Netherlands. We were trying to develop an ESG and impact measurement framework, which we hope can be complementary to many other existing reporting and measurement frameworks out there. So we recognize that people not only care about financial capital, so people also care about other types of capital, such as manufactured capital, the goods we produce, intellectual capital, so the knowledge we create, natural capital, the environmental impact we create, social capital, so how we affect the community, people, worker around us, and human capital, right? So how employees feel, they are affected by the organizations or by investments. And we also not only focus on investors, we also focus on other types of stakeholders. So this is like two extensions of the traditional financial analysis. When we think about traditional financial analysis, we mostly think about traditional profit and loss, P&L, which we just care about one single number, whether it's profit or it's loss, for one single stakeholder, who is investor. The first extension we want to make is we still care about the financial impact, but not only for investors, but also for a broader group of stakeholders, employees, consumers, community, government, etc. Another extension we want to make is we not only consider the financial impact on different stakeholders, but we also want to consider other types of impact for all stakeholders. So we look at manufactured capital, intellectual capital, natural capital, etc., which represents other types of impact. And with this impact measurement framework in mind, which, as I mentioned, hopefully will complement many existing frameworks, we analyze what's the impact. It's a pilot study. What's the impact of a bank's lending to a different sector? Here is an example of DBS Bank lending to the palm oil sector. So as you know, lending to palm oil can lead to paying salaries to workers, paying taxes to local authorities, generating profits. All these are considered as economic contribution and they are positive impacts. Palm oil can also be used to make other products, for example, tire, soap, etc. So these are, again, positive impacts in terms of producing consumer goods. Palm oil is associated with climate change, loss of biodiversity, land use. So these are negative environmental impacts. So these are environmental costs and is associated with child labor, with worker abuse, with other social issues. So these are negative social costs. But of course, hiring workers at the palm oil plantation is a positive contribution to employment. So there is also a positive social effect. As I mentioned earlier, we try to have this framework to quantify and also to monetize different types of impact. In other words, we not only want to report impact in their original natural units, we want to report them in monetary units. So if we report them in monetary units, if you look at the graph on the right, the vertical axis is now represented in Singapore dollar, then all different types of impacts for all different types of stakeholders have the same unit, the dollar amount. So they are directly comparable. So you have some positive impact, mostly from salaries, taxes, profit, and you have some negative impacts, mostly from environmental damage you create. So now you can have a better idea of what's the net impact. So from a bank's perspective, not necessarily DBS, but many other banks, not only in Singapore, but around the world, you will have a better idea of when making this particular investment by lending to a particular sector, how much positive impact you generate, how much negative impact you generate, and what's the net impact. So if the net impact is still positive, whether it's still meaningful to make this particular investment. So I just very briefly describe this short project that we did with DBS and also with Impact Institute. And after this project, SMU Impact Institute and other organizations around the world, including Harvard Business School, we now form a working group to develop a so-called impact-weighted account framework. So the idea is we want to utilize this impact measurement framework I just presented to you. We want to quantify impact, we want to monetize impact, and we want to look at different type of capital and different type of stakeholders, such that organizations in the future, when they report their ESG impact, they may have an alternative and hopefully more transparent, more reliable source or a reliable way of thinking. So with this, I want to conclude my part, and I will hand back to Su Yun for maybe Q&A.
Thank you, Dr. Liang Hao. Excellent segue for us to ask some interesting questions. We have already two questions from members of the audience. We have a Mr. Lee, who is asking about the difference between CSR and ESG. Does the ESG serve to complement, supplement, replace, extend the endeavors of CSR, or is it to be used as a backfill to the shortfalls of CSR? So an interesting question. Why don't I pose this question to maybe Yolanda? Because I remember correctly that banks at one stage was very much into CSR and practices of CSR. So Yolanda, would you like to take on this question? Thank you.
Certainly. I think if you look at the abbreviations literally, corporate social responsibility and ESG, they seem to lead to similar things. In practice, CSR as an abbreviation or a term to describe companies' endeavors in sustainability tend to be tainted with the connotation that you are only doing something for reputation reasons or for charity reasons, whereas ESG is a summary of terms to denote a firm's ambition to address environmental, social, governance, sort of all encompassing the material aspects of their operation and the associated impacts. So I would say these days, it is a little bit frowned upon for companies to say they do CSR. ESG is kind of the new, more favored term, but I can understand the confusion because, you know, if you look at the literal elaboration of the terms, a company being socially responsible is fine and good.
Thank you, Yolanda. And also a follow-up question, and I think I would pose this to Dr. Lal as he was talking about the United Nations and their role in ESG. This member of the audience also wants to know, to what extent is ESG intertwined with the 10 principles of the UN Global Compact? Please, Dr. Lal.
Yeah. So So I guess the best way to explain this is that the 10 principles of the UN Global Compact are one expression and one standard, if you like, that manifests the new concern about ESG. I think there's been a lot of discussion, and you heard from Professor Hao, there is need for standardization and measurement when it comes to all these issues pertaining to quantifying progress towards quote-unquote green economy. There are many different firms that claim that they are ESG compliant, but since there are no set standards, the reality is that there is great variability. So some investors might claim that they adhere to the 10 principles of the UN Global Compact. You will find others that adhere to some different convention. And there are multiple conventions that have some overlapping concepts, complementary concepts, but there is no standardization. This is not something that will be easily achievable, but it is something that we must strive towards to bring greater discipline to how we measure, manage, and monitor progress towards greening our economies.
Thank you, Dr. Lal. The question seems to be coming fast and furious from members of the audience. I have another attendee from a member of the audience asking the question about how do we accurately measure the cost of social impacts. And I would like to pose this to Michele, because I think, Michele, in your presentation, you had spoken regarding the social impact and the ESG. And I guess this is important because you're investing and you're identifying companies that would meet certain criteria. So how would you then, as a fund manager, look at measuring the cost of social impacts?
So as I mentioned earlier, as a fund manager, especially as a fund manager and invest very broadly, it is difficult to go to the level of detail of measuring the cost of social impact for a specific company. And therefore, fund managers like StashAway, again, with a broad mandate, will actually rely on the evaluation of third parties. I mentioned MSCI and Morningstar as two institutions that have actually started to measure, broadly speaking, ESG scores. And then if you go into the details, they actually divide, you know, environmental, social, and governance scores. Obviously, if you are a fund manager, or more broadly speaking, you just want to measure the cost of social impact for a specific company, for a specific industry, then you can probably be more specific. You can actually make some assumptions. As discussed, I think broadly in all of the presentations, one of the issues of this topic is that it's difficult to be standardized metrics across the board. I think Professor Hao earlier actually showed a study that was done on a bank financing a specific sector, so palm oil, and then you can actually make more precise assumptions, and you can actually go one level deeper into the detail of what is the cost or benefit of impact across all dimensions, including social. But obviously, at that point, you need to make a lot of assumptions on, you're hopefully directionally right, but it's never going to be precisely correct.
Thank you, Michele. Oh, wow, we're really getting it fast and furious. So we have another member of the audience who's asking, what do you actually do with waste from transitioning to a greener practice? I think, you know, there's two elements to this. So on one part, there is Tesla and batteries. So, you know, I think Dr. Lal, you had spoken about transition, the macro issue, you know, when you transition and what do you do with, like, for example, you've given the coal. But here they're asking about Tesla and batteries. So it's great you built Tesla electronic cars, but then what do you do with the batteries when they have their shelf life has ended? Because that is then now e-waste and it's lithium. You can't really throw in the ocean, it'll blow up. So what can you do about it? And I think the other follow-up to that, Perhaps Yolanda could help enlighten us a bit, because I think, Yolanda, you talked about DBS having transition projects. So what would be interesting, similar to transition issues, is then what does DBS do to monitor the transition process of some of your clients as they try to get more ESG compliant? So would Dr. Lau, would you like to start first? Thank you.
Let me have a go at this. I'm not an engineer or a scientist, but I guess the broader question or issue that is embedded in the query is it a never-ending quest? I'll give you another example along the lines of the question asked. It's not just Tesla and batteries, but you know, intuitively, we all believe that digitization, you know, you get rid of paper, you simplify communications, you get rid of a lot of transportation, that should actually be environmentally positive. But as it turns out, digital business models require to be supported by server farms. And server farms are hugely intensive in their energy consumption. So it is true that as we look for solutions in one segment of the economy to make that more resource initiative, more resource intensive and efficient, we are opening up other Pandora's boxes along the way. But this is a huge opportunity. I mean, I think there is a lot of funds being invested and a lot of time and effort being expended on decarbonization strategies generally and carbon sequestration. I'm sure the scientific solutions are there. It is a matter of time that these solutions, become more commercially viable, and you will see as problems arise, there'll be solutions to each one of them that we will navigate.
Thank you, Dr. Lal. Yolanda, would you like to then follow up with what DBS is doing in terms of transitions?
Yes, I think I would also follow a similar approach to Dr. Lau's answer. Rather than talking specifically about Tesla and battery, let's talk broadly about what is the business model that we are using these days in our economy, which is the linear model. You extract natural resources from planet Earth, you produce something out of those resources, you consume it, and then at the end, it becomes waste. That's the linear business model. And increasingly, besides the green economy, we are also talking about a circular economy. A circular business model suggests that we can actually close the loop from natural resources extraction to production to consumption, and the waste from one sector would no longer be considered waste. It's feedstock for another industry, or it can be repurposed, recycled, reused for further production and consumption, so the cycle goes on. Now, that's very easy to say in theory. In practice, we do know that the solar panels, the wind turbines that are now coming to the end of their shelf life now is generating a huge waste problem. Now, I would be quite optimistic about the advances in technological solutions. So these days, we are aware that there are now solutions, wind turbines that are made of partly of recycled materials. So we know that as a result of that, the resources that go into the production of each wind turbine will be largely minimized. So I feel that the circular economy, it is a hard nut to crack, but it is the ultimate goal that we should aim for.
Thank you, Yolanda. I have another question, not from me, but it's from Mr. Philip Lee. And he's asking, what is the impact or implication of ESG on companies' annual report? And he's asking, for example, does reporting ESG performance in the annual report make a difference for the application of financial schemes, such as those offered by DBS? Perhaps Professor Liang Hao, you have done a lot of research on that area. Would you like to pick up Mr. Lee's question regarding the performance in the annual report and what is the application of it on financial schemes. Thank you.
Yeah, sure. So there are different types of ESG reporting practice. For example, you can issue a separate ESG report. I think that's what majority of the companies are doing around the world, and you follow different standards. I think the most widely adopted standard is so-called Global Reporting Initiative, GRI. I think more than 80% of public companies are doing that. Or you can adopt the so-called integrated reporting framework, the IR standard. So integrated reporting means basically you report financial information together with ESG information in the same report rather than issuing a separate ESG report. And there are academic evidence showing that companies which adopt integrated reporting practice, they experience a higher market valuation. The idea is that they release more information to the market, not only more information, but more quality information, because in this way, investors and other stakeholders, they have an easier time to evaluate what's the financial impact of your ESG commitment. So not just reading ESG report as a side report, but actually think about how ESG actually affects your financial fundamentals. So I think that is the trend. Although integrated reporting practice is not as prevalent as we were hoping for, but more and more companies, including many listed companies on Singapore Stock Exchange, SGX, they are gradually adopting integrated reporting practice. And I think this is the future direction, both from academic evidence and also from many investors' wise. They do hope that, we don't want to just read a report which, shows something that we don't know how to relate to the financials. We want to know, what's the, financial implications of the things. So I think this may, hopefully this may address your question.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Lang. I have another question from a Lim Min Hui, a member of the audience. Perhaps, Michele, you would like to pick up on this because you're an investor, and I'm sure you're not just purely looking at listed companies. This question is targeted at the outline of the Singapore's Green Plan 2030. There is a need to start corporates and especially SMEs on the sustainability path. But then again, with SMEs firefighting and heavily involved in operations and all, what do you think SMEs can do to start their journey on this sustainability pathway? That's the question.
So it's obviously a very broad question, meaning that it depends from the SMEs, it depends from the sector, it depends from the stage, it depends from the size. So it's difficult to give a kind of all-in answer. But in general, my perspective is that not just SMEs, but any institution should always start whatever journey, in this case, the journey toward more stronger perspective on sustainability with small steps. And as I mentioned earlier, ESG is a, or sustainability, is a broad topic where there is environmental impact. There is, so let's focus maybe on environmental and social and leave governance aside for a second. So if you focus on environmental and social impact, depending on the industry and the sector in which the SME is, the company might have a larger or smaller impact on either of these two large parts. So for instance, if it's an SME with a manufacturing facility, worth looking at what happens to the scrap material used in the manufacturing, or worth looking at working conditions for blue collar employees. And so that's an example. If you're looking at professional firms, perhaps one of the biggest impact is around traveling. Looking at, obviously we just went through a crash course on how to avoid traveling over the last year and a half. So I guess it's going to be easier now, but still, I guess it remains a hot topic. If you were a law firm or a consulting firm, probably your biggest environmental impact comes from traveling. And so how can you reduce traveling? And again, we just went through a crash course, so I guess now we're all better equipped than we were a year and a half ago to do that. And so I think that the answer to the question is, look at maybe one thing where the company can do something, start from there. Don't try to do everything at once because you're never going to have the resources. Pick one thing which makes a lot of sense given the business model of the company, given the sector, and focus on that. And then 6 months later, a year later, 2 years later, whenever you think you made enough progress, you can think about, okay, what did we learn? What can we apply to other areas? You know, maybe I can expand my impact in other areas. And I think there is, you know, every company will have. So maybe if I had something, you know, the one part of the question says the companies are firefighting and are heavily involved in operations. But on the bright side, this is a topic that will probably excite some of the team members, particularly maybe some of the younger team members. And therefore, you may actually find people that are willing to spend an extra hour or two every day to work on this topic without leaving some of the other topics just because they want to do something good. And so you may actually find that you already have the resources and the willingness to do things. You just need to look for that.
Thank you, Michele. And I think right now we have one final question, and it's really about reporting and monitoring. And the question is really around affordability. You know, for any company, big or small, the process of trying to create a report for ESG is not cheap. So perhaps Dr. Liang Hao, you would like to share with us some of your thoughts. How do you make it affordable to start on this journey? Thank you.
Okay, sure. I think this is a result of market equilibrium in the sense that how much a company want to report and how much investors want to hear, want to see, right? So this is an equilibrium result. I think there was a concern when impact investing practice was introduced that many companies were arguing that, you know, we are already reporting a lot. And if we keep on reporting, you know, other information, ESG information, and also put them into the financial report, then, you know, you are just overburdening us. But on the other hand, you know, investors react to the issuance of their integrated report of ESG report. So there is benefit to that. So I think even for smaller companies, they also have this cost and benefit trade-off. On one hand, it's time consuming, it's requiring a lot of resources to compile those reports. But on the other hand, you know, investors need additional information, especially for SMEs, you know, for which they are not that transparent. They are opaque, more opaque in nature. So investors probably need more information about their ESG practice. So I think for companies, different companies of different size, there's a different optimal level of how much they can report. So a policy implication, you know, from a academic perspective, is that maybe we shouldn't, you know, require the same level of ESG reporting for all type of companies, but you know, reporting on ESG information is crucial. Investors are looking at those issues. Even for non-listed companies, you know, those startups, impact investors, many private equity, venture capital funds, they look for ESG information. So reporting is crucial. It's just a matter of how much you report would match with how much investors demand. So this is, you know, what I think.
Thank you. Thank you, Liang. I guess it's like what makes common sense and what needs to be reported. And that's the guiding star so that you don't go overboard and don't go underboard. But I guess it's also a matter of fine tuning it and making mistakes along the journey. So with that, all the questions, I would like to conclude our panel discussion.